Vitamin B1. You may have heard it called thiamine. This is all about how to manage your thiamine status. Hi, I'm Dr. Chris Masterjohn of chrismasterjohnphd.com, and this is Chris Masterjohn Lite, where the name of the game is details, schmetails, just tell me what works. And today we're going to talk about managing vitamin B1 status. Thiamine is very important for energy metabolism in general, but it's especially important for carbohydrate metabolism. So one of the things that you'll see in a moderate thiamine deficiency is poor glucose tolerance, hyperglycemia, or doing better on a low-carbohydrate diet than on a high-carbohydrate diet. Classically, there are three thiamine deficiency syndromes that dominate what we know about thiamine. These are beriberi, Wernicke's encephalopathy, and Korsakoff psychosis. These generally involve signs and symptoms like peripheral neuropathy, which is weakness, numbness, pain, or tingling in the hands and feet, impairments in your reflexes, weakness or paralysis of the muscles around the eye, sometimes changes in your heart rate and heart output. And in the case of Korsakoff psychosis, you can get very severe cognitive changes like amnesia, making false memories, and being overcome by apathy. In these severe cases, thiamine deficiency can cause seizures, paralysis, and death. But what we're more likely to encounter are the moderate deficits that lead to poor glucose tolerance and poor ability to handle carbohydrate in the diet. Why might you get a thiamine deficiency? Well, this is the interesting case because most of what there is to say is not about diet. Dietarily, you need several servings per day of meat, legumes, whole grains, or enriched grains, meaning refined grains that have been fortified with thiamine, which is most refined grains. If you don't get these foods, you could have a dietary thiamine deficiency. This was common back in the day when refined foods started dominating the diet before we started fortifying them with thiamine. It's not so common anymore. Nowadays, you could imagine that if you're on a high-fat ketogenic diet and you are scared of protein, and so you're not eating very much meat, then a diet that is mostly fat could give you a thiamine deficiency. But a carnivore can get enough thiamine, eat the meat. A vegan can get enough thiamine, eat the legumes and grains. So most people are not gonna have a thiamine deficiency from diet. With that said, there are several cases where we know very well that non-dietary phenomena can lead to thiamine deficiency. That's with persistent vomiting, alcoholism, and HIV or AIDS. In diabetes, the need for thiamine goes up. There are other things that are less well understood but are still quite fascinating that can cause thiamine deficiency in the environment. These include thiaminases, which are enzymes that break down thiamine. And these can be found in raw fish and shellfish. Not all of them. We don't really know all the things that causes the level of thiaminases to vary in raw fish and shellfish. But if you eat a lot of raw fish and shellfish, that could theoretically contribute to a thiamine deficiency. Microbes in your gut, indoor toxic molds, amoebas polluting the water. Varieties of microbes can produce thiaminases that degrade thiamine. Sulfite, which is used as a food additive and which we also produce in our body when we don't have enough of the mineral molybdenum in our diet, can also degrade thiamine. So if you have any signs and symptoms of thiamine deficiency and you have any of these plausible risk factors that make it make sense that thiamine could be your problem, the best thing to do is to verify this with blood testing. The simplest and easiest test to get that I would recommend is LabCorp's thiamine pyrophosphate test in whole blood. I do not recommend the test that Quest has. If you want to dive deeper into this than that, there is a company called HDRI, or Health Diagnostics Research Institute. Your doctor would have to order this. Your doctor can go to their website, get the requisition form, and check off the box that says ETKA. That stands for erythrocyte transketolase activity. And if that's low, that's an indicator of poor thiamine status. In addition, if you get plasma amino acids or urinary organic acids, you could look for elevations of the amino acid alanine or pyruvate or more commonly lactate. And in the urine, you could look for lactate, pyruvate, and alpha-ketoglutarate, which is also called 2-oxoglutarate. If you see these patterns, or if you simply see low whole blood thiamine pyrophosphate, those are all consistent with thiamine deficiency. The ultimate test is to see whether these symptoms and the blood work or urine work respond well to fixing the thiamine deficit. If the problem is dietary, fix the diet first. If the problem is a medical condition, work with your doctor on a medical condition. Either to get better faster or because the underlying solution is not clear, thiamine supplementation is a safe and effective way to replete thiamine status. So in most cases, 100 milligrams of thiamine hydrochloride is probably adequate. There's also a thiamine supplement called benfotiamin that might work better for the neurological problems seen in alcoholism and diabetes. And there's a thiamine supplement called thiamine pyrophosphate, TPP, or thiamine diphosphate, TDP. This is the active form, and that's best if you have a problem activating thiamine to the active form. We don't know if that happens outside of alcoholism, but we know that it does happen in alcoholism, so maybe it also occurs in other situations. So the simplest thing is to start with thiamine hydrochloride, but if you want to trial and error your way through these other thiamine supplements to see if they give you more benefit, then that makes sense. There are no known risks to taking thiamine supplements. All right, I hope you found this useful. Signing off, this is Chris Masterjohn of chrismasterjohnphd.com. This has been Chris Masterjohn Lite, and I will see you in the next episode.